It is up to you.
Okay. Larry, I guess you can hear me, is that correct?
Well, yes, sir.
Thanks, everyone, for attending. Okay, great. Thanks, everybody, for attending. I'm Paul Livingston, a volunteer for the FairTax. It is a national organization known as Americans for Fair Taxation, but we use the name FairTax. In my presentation tonight, I'm going to use the problem-solution format. It's a great way to not only gain the audience attention, but to help them understand the problems as well as the solutions, and it's a persuasive tool as well in using the problem-solution format. So let's get started with a short story. For some reason, my slide does not want to advance.
Click on the slide with your mouse pointer, and then it'll work. It should work from that.
Click on the slide. Okay. The story starts on July 4th, 1776. That's the day we declared our independence from the English crown. That's the day we declared our freedom from government.
Paul, and your slide did not advance.
But did on mine.
Okay. Anyone out there? There you go. I see it now.
Okay, great. Okay, we're going now. Okay, so we gained our freedom from government and tax tyranny. We won the war, we won our freedom, and then we wrote the Constitution that was actually signed in 1787. This document is the only document we have that protects us from government. It protects our God-given right to our production, that is income, savings, and investments. And the Constitution as written protected us from direct taxation. And all was going well until the 16th Amendment. That was passed in February of 1913. This amendment enabled direct taxation without limits on us. The government gained huge new taxing powers, and we the people lost freedom, liberty, and civil rights. The 16th Amendment enabled the first legal income tax. It enabled the IRS, payroll taxes, and tax withholding. But most importantly, it also enabled a progressive graduated income tax. This is the second requirement for a communist state as defined by the Communist Manifesto written by Karl Marx. And that amendment is in our Constitution. After 102 years under the 16th Amendment, the tax code has become a cancer. Now, the non-medical definition of a cancer is a deadly spreading evil. Our tax code has grown to over 74,000 pages. We no longer understand it. It's impossible to administer. But let's take a look at some of the problems and the issues that we're faced today. And as we take a look at these problems, think about which ones are most important to you. And remember, the choices we make are most important to us as an individual. Choices determine who we are, and it also determines who we are as a nation. The number one problem is the IRS. Everybody fears the IRS. Isn't that tax tyranny? As I said, the tax code has grown to over 74,000 pages. It's too large to administer. Nobody understands it. And the IRS is used for political gains. That is a huge problem. But we talked about stopping direct taxation and this annual tax filing. You know, with the direct taxation, government gained power and we lost freedom. This is a huge problem. But today, everybody's still screaming, we need jobs, jobs, and economic stimulus. They want a program that works. They keep trying the old programs again and again. They don't work. And we want a program that will work without government spending and new debt. This is a huge problem. Now let's stop punishing good behavior. And you think about taxing production, which our present code does, that first of all, for you to create wealth, to enjoy a higher standard of living, there has to be production. There won't be any improvement without production. But yet we tax production. Our present tax code is based on taxing income, savings, and investment. Would you like to have more take-home pay, more disposable income? There's this talk that the middle class isn't realizing any increase in pay or purchasing power. You suppose that has to do with our present tax code? Take a look at the withholding, just the payroll taxes of 7.65% is taken out of your pay. There's also the income tax withholding that further reduces your purchasing power. United we stand, divided we fall. Yet our tax code divides us into classes on what percentage of income tax you pay. Does this make any sense? I call this one the stay out of jail card. We spend upwards of $430 billion a year to just comply with our tax code. This is a huge industry in itself. It doesn't help us at all to improve our standard of living or to save and produce. It is a big waste, a big burden on us. How would you like to even the playing field between imported goods and USA-made goods? Well, let's stop to think about this one for a minute. We have the highest tax codes, business tax codes, in the world within the United States. And these taxes get passed on in higher prices. And imported goods come into our country, and they don't carry that tax burden. And I'll talk about this issue more later on. It's a huge problem, all created by our present tax code. Which is more important to you? The care and feeding of your family or paying taxes? Which would you like to put first? And I'll talk about this subject a little bit later as well. How about showing compassion for the and helping most of the impoverished and the lower income? The present tax code does just the opposite. And what about jobs and creation and tax refunds to help the impoverished and the lower income? There's a huge economy out in our country that goes untaxed. It's called the underground economy. And it's estimated to be between $1 and $2 trillion. This is about, our total economy is about $14 trillion. So you can see it's a big percentage of our economy that's going untaxed. Is this a problem that you're concerned about? And then there's this cheating. Now, nobody likes a cheater. There's a lot of it going on today. How would you like to solve that problem? Have everybody have some skin in the game and paying taxes. Here's a dirty little secret, and it's okay to tell the 47%ers that think they're not paying taxes, to tell them about this one. Today, in the prices of the goods and services we buy, there are about 22 cents per dollar of hidden taxes. These hidden taxes are collected by businesses in the form of higher prices. And so this business taxes end up being paid by the final consumer, that's you and me, in the form of a regressive hidden sales tax. Is this a problem? This is just crazy. We have a tax code that is driving jobs, companies, and capital out of our country, out of our economy. And at the same time, the same high tax code discourages jobs, companies, and capitals from entering our economy. We've got to change this. Do you know what the number one commodity in Washington, D.C. is? It's the federal tax code. The politicians, the lobbyists, and the special interest groups are buying and selling the tax code. How do these politicians get the big war chest to campaign again, get reelected, and to continue to hold their elected office? The tax code is a great facilitator for this process. And you think if the politicians could no longer use this tax code, that we would get a different kind of politician in Washington, D.C. We've covered 15 problems. Which one is at the top of your list? It's a tough choice, isn't it? But tell you what, let's go for all of them. Let's solve all of these problems, all 15 of them. But can you imagine the solution coming out of the Beltway? Do you think the politicians and the lobbyists are going to come up with the answer? And the flat tax is not the solution. The flat tax still taxes income. It still needs the 16th Amendment. It needs the IRS. It relies upon direct taxation and payroll taxes and tax withholding. The flat taxes are not the solution. The solution came from a group of private concerned citizens. They raised some $22 million in private funds to do research, study, and focus groups. They employed some of the better economists in the country from MIT and Harvard and think tanks like Cato Institute and the Heritage Foundation. And do you know what the results were? The solution was to move the tax base from income, savings, and investment, to move the tax base from production to a tax base on consumption. The solution is called the FairTax, and it is a bill now in Congress. You can find it on the internet. It's called H.R. 25 in the House and S1. 55 in the Senate, but it's one tax, a progressive sales consumption tax system on all goods and services and not on used goods. The Fair Tax Plan is one tax on all new goods and services at 23 cents per dollar. Now this works out to 23% inclusive if you include the tax in the price of the good, or 30% if you add it on to the cost of the good before you sell it. It's only 131 pages long. It's double-spaced, and it replaces some 74,000 pages of tax code and regulations, but yet it collects the same amount of money as the present tax system that it replaces. Fair tax eliminates a bunch of taxes. It eliminates the federal, corporate, and personal income taxes, gift taxes, estate taxes, capital gains tax, the alternative minimum tax, Social Security and Medicare taxes, but it does not change Social Security and Medicare in any way. It does put the funding of these two programs on a larger and more stable tax base. The FairTax also eliminates the self-employment tax. The tax plan includes a monthly tax refund called the prebate. It eliminates, and I'll talk in more detail about the prebate in a minute. It eliminates some 22 cents per dollar in hidden embedded taxes. Disposable income, spendable income increases. The systems and the processes are now in place for the states collecting the sales tax and the Social Security Administration managing the prebate. As far as the prebate, it's designed to untax all legal residents up to their subsistence level with a monthly tax refund or rebate. We call it a prebate because it's received the first of the month. Here are some examples. Let's take the family of two adults and two children. According to the Department of Health and Human Services, which is now determining the subsistence level of expenditures for various family sizes, they do it now to do the COLA, cost of living adjustments, every year. You take that spending amount for this family unit of two adults and two children, multiply it by 23%, and you get them paying on those subsistence level of expenditures $7,328. When you divide that by 12, and you get $612 per month. This is the amount of money that will be refunded every month to this family of two adults and two children to untax them up to the subsistence level of expenditures. Another example, two adults, let's say they're either a newly married couple or maybe they're empty nesters. Their monthly refund or prebate would be $451. And a single person, their monthly refund would be $228. So you see how the prebate works in terms of the monthly refunds that most likely would be sent to you electronically if you have a checking account or a savings account. There are other ways it can be easily distributed as well besides mailing out all the checks. There are two important things about the prebate. Is that first, it changes a traditional sales tax into a progressive tax program. By that I mean, let's take this family of two adults and two children again. Now perhaps they grow a lot of food, they live out in the country, whatever. They're frugal. Maybe they're getting by on $20,000 of spending a year. That's all they spend. Maybe that's all they have to spend. Well, because of that family size, they're getting a prebate of $7,236 a year. But the amount of money that they're putting into the FairTax for their expenditures is only $4,600. So they're actually coming out to the good. They're making money on the prebate. That situation continues at their $25,000 spending level. When you get up to the $31,000 spending, that's basically a break even, where the family is now, what they spend on new goods and services and paying the fair tax is now rebated equal to what they're paying into the fair tax. But as their income goes up, their wealth goes up to the point where they can enjoy a higher standard of living. Let's say they can spend $45,000. Now they're putting into fair tax $10,350, but the prebate is less than that. So they now have an effective tax rate of just short of 7%. And as their spending goes up, to say 75,000, the effective rate goes to 13.4. And if they can spend $150,000 a year, the effective tax rate is 18.2, and it continues to progress upwards to, it will progress up to 23%, but never actually reach 23% because of the prebate. So what this graph shows is that the FairTax is a progressive tax system. So this is important to understand, because people will talk about FairTax and say it's a sales tax. I don't like sales tax because they are a progressive tax system. FairTax is more than just a sales consumption tax. It has two parts to it. It also has the prebate. We also talked about jobs and stimulating the economy. Let's go back to those hidden taxes. When a business gets taxed, that's just another cost to the business. Now, how does a business pay all their costs? They get all the money to pay all their costs from the prices that they get from the goods they sell. So you put more business taxes on, you're raising the prices. And these prices, these expenses get passed down within the distribution channel from the producer to the distributor to the retailer to finally the final consumer. The final consumer is paying all of these hidden taxes, and they're paying them in the form of a regressive hidden sales tax. So when you eliminate business taxes, income taxes, capital gains taxes, the costs of goods go down. That means the U.S. businesses are more competitive in the world markets, demand for U.S. goods and services go up, and USA becomes a tax-free business haven. Our tax code is no longer driving jobs and businesses and capital out of our economy or discouraging them from coming in. And offshore capital will flow in by some $10 trillion. You probably heard earlier this year that, for example, Congress, I think it was the House, called the Apple Corporation in. They want to say, you know, Apple's a worldwide company. In fact, China is soon going to be a bigger market than the USA for Apple products. And the Congress wanted, or the House wanted to know, why aren't you bringing this money inshore? Hey, Apple isn't stupid. Apple is doing it to avoid taxes. Why should I bring the profits into the country? It'll just get taxed. So with the FairTax, you have a huge new jobs and economic growth program. We have this growth program without the politicians and the lobbyists and the special interest groups picking winners and losers. We get this program without any new debt. We get this jobs and stimulus program just by changing the tax code. Now, they did some projections when they did this study, and they projected out all the major economic indicators by 10 years, out 10 years into the future. And all the major economic indicators, gross domestic product, employment, investment, consumption, are all up. It shows a picture of a beautiful, vibrant, growing economic country. There's much to like by the FairTax. It's a nonpartisan bill. It's a nonpartisan program. We don't support any political party or any candidates. We look for them to support us. There's much for everybody to like with the FairTax. It helps everybody. It can be a unifier. It can bring our country together again. At that point, I'd like to stop and see if there are any questions.
Okay, I've got a whole book here for you, and from one of the listeners tonight. There are 21 candidates for President of the United States. Oh, it sounds like we're getting a seminar here. The time is right. People are tired of the IRS. The IRS is not controlled and has become corrupt. It is difficult to get these candidates to sit down and read the FairTax book, a short but power-packed and sensible book. Are there representatives from FairTax approaching to explain and gain the support of the 21 candidates regarding the FairTax? Excuse me. Can you imagine a debate between the candidates for all and sponsoring the FairTax? And this is from David. Okay, you want to grab that one, Paul?
Okay. David, thanks for your question. First of all, please understand that we do have co-sponsors for the bill now. In the House, we have 70 co-sponsors. In the Senate, we have 6 co-sponsors. In both the House and the Senate, we have a sponsor for the bill. So in total, that gives us 78. Now, as far as actually meeting with the congressman, we are a volunteer organization. Volunteers are going to Washington, D.C. as best they can on their nickel and their dime. We are a grassroots organization. For us to increase our activities, to add skilled lobbyists and to get a lobbying office and to help us expand and improve our website and our national emailing programs, we need funds. We need contributions. And it's important to understand, large donors are out there. They're all over the place. They know about the FairTax. But they evaluate a grassroots organization on a number of things, one of which is there a grassroots collection of volunteers to sustain the organization? They don't want to be investing in a weak organization. That's an indication of strength. So what is being said is large contributors, big contributors, follow the lead of small contributors. We are in a fundraising campaign right now, and that's called the 1040 Club. I encourage all of you tonight to go to fairtax.org and become a club member of 1040. And that is, you are pledging to contribute $10.40 per month to the FairTax grassroots cause. You can contribute more than that, but I encourage you to contribute out of your pocket and encourage others to do the same. Larry, do you have anything you want to add to that?
Not only, I think you've covered that one pretty well. I would suggest that if any of these candidates come into your area, into your community someplace, and you can get to it, the best thing that you can do is formulate a good question for them to find out where they stand on the FairTax. And yeah, I like to ask, you know, there's a lot of talk about H.R. 25, the FairTax Act. It's a highly researched program. We've got 80 co-sponsors now in the House and Senate, and I'd like to know if you will be a co-sponsor should you be elected, or will you be elected, if you're elected as president, will you sign the FairTax bill if it is presented to you, and see what they say. And you know, possibly, well, I'm not going to guess. I'm not going to hypothesize on what they might say. You'll get all kinds of answers. Some of them will flat out lie, but some of them will be sincere in their response, even though they might be wrong. You'll have to be the judge of that. But that's what I would strongly suggest. Okay? And yes, as Paul said, as volunteers, most of us, or many of us, are looking for opportunities to get with these various candidates. Some of them have already made up their minds they want a flat tax, and that's just protecting the status quo because an income tax is the golden goose that lays the eggs for our elected, I hate to use the word representatives, but that's what they are supposed to be. Okay, let's see what we got next here.
And the last question. As far as all the candidates, Governor Mike Huckabee is a strong advocate for the fair tax. And his platform is, includes the fair tax. He talks about it all the time. Ted Cruz, the senator from Texas, is a co-sponsor of the fair tax bill. However, he's been known to say that he also likes the flat tax, and he would like to eliminate the IRS. Well, you can't do both of those. But for the flat tax, you need the IRS. So we're not quite sure if Ted Cruz understands the fair tax or not, or whether he's playing both ends against the middle. But it's important to set these politicians straight and to understand that, that just about every one of them has some kind of tax comment in their platform.
Yeah, can you spell pandering? Pandering, Ted Cruz is pandering. Would you say that?
Yeah.
Okay. This is from, I don't know if I'm going to say this right, and forgive me if I do not. It's either Attilo or Attilo. Who did the study you quoted at the end? All right, what the study you quoted, Paul, at the end, who did that?
Ooh, that was done by the Americans for Fair Taxation, and exactly which economists, I could look that up. You could look that up yourself. It's on the internet at fairtax.org. But exactly who did that study on that, I don't know.
Okay. Is that something you can find rapidly or not?
No.
No? Okay. Attilo or Attilo, please forgive me again. If you will send me an email, Paul will look that up and I'll respond with his response, or I'll give him your email and he can respond directly, whichever works out easier. If you would do that, that'll be fine. Okay. Now, Bruce had his hand raised a while ago. I am going to unmute you, Bruce. Well, I can't because your hand is not raised anymore. Bruce lowered his hand after sending me a text message. Okay, here's what he wanted to say. Besides Florida, how many states have passed a fair tax memorial? Paul?
That's a good question. The Florida legislature last year passed what's called a memorial. It's passed like regular legislation. It goes through committees and it's voted on the House and the Senate, signed by the governor. And it's the memorial states, it's a message to the U.S. Congress, the House and the Senate, as well as the president, encouraging them to pass the fair tax bill. You can look it up. It's SM-118 on the internet. You'll find that bill. Florida is the third most populous state in the nation, and we're the first state to have passed a memorial. This is a very strong positive sign. I think other states that are working on memorials include Georgia, Missouri. Do you know of any others?
I do know that Texas is working on it. Peggy out there, our government representative for the fair tax, is working in the state of Texas to get a memorial passed. That was not an easy job. It took us, I say us, when our director in Florida, our state director, directing manager, managing director, whatever his title is, he actually put the majority of the time into getting this done and spent a lot of time in Tallahassee talking to the various representatives and senators, and it did get the job done last year. Okay, I've got another question. This one, from Attilo again. If implemented, what do you think will induce business to reduce prices initially by the 22%, Paul?
Oh, that's a simple question. Competition. And the day the fair tax gets passed, everybody, I should say everybody, most of the people will understand the fair tax, and they will be looking for price reductions before the fair tax is added. So Walmart, I mean, somewhere upwards of 80-90% of consumption is done through the big box stores, the chain stores, the Walmarts, the Kmarts, Publix, the grocery chains, Home Depot, Lowe's, you go on and on. And the internet gets taxed as well with the fair tax. So that is all very exposed consumption, and it's all under price. There's tremendous price competition every day. So the prices will get driven down.
Okay, this might be a good time to point out to everybody that the embedded costs, the embedded taxes that are in everything we purchase today actually range from 20 to 25% depending on the industry you're talking about. And so the 22% that Paul mentioned is kind of an average. He could have said 22 or 23, but he chose 22, and it does, you know, that's close enough. The fact of the matter is, and Paul used the example of Home Depot, and if you take a Home Depot and a Lowe's, one of those companies lowers their rates and the other one does not, you know where all of the business is going to go. And that's the same thing that will happen with the other stores, as Paul had pointed out. And Attila is also asking if or is there any Democratic co-sponsors?
That's a good question. The fair tax used to have some Democrat co-sponsors as well. In fact, when the bill was first introduced, a Republican and a Democrat would join hands and they would become co-sponsors at the same time. Well, when the Democrat Party got control of Congress, all that stopped. For whatever reason, and I don't know how many bills are included in total, but the Democrat Party has told their membership that if you become a co-sponsor for the fair tax, you lose your committee privileges. Now, there are probably other bills that fall into that category as well, but that is why at the present time there are no Democrats that are co-sponsoring the bill.
Okay, and just to add on to what Paul said, we did have one co-sponsor in Oklahoma up until the last session of Congress when he chose not to run for re-election. And he was asked, why did he co-sponsor the bill in view of the fact that Nancy Pelosi had mandated that no Democrat should provide any support for the fair tax? Otherwise, as Paul mentioned, they wouldn't get good committee assignments and she would not support them for re-election. His answer was very curt, and he just said, Nancy Pelosi does not vote in my district. And that's really a very powerful message. That tells you how powerful our vote can be. And the goal of each of us in various congressional districts around the country who are active promoting the fair tax, our goal is to get enough fair tax supporters in that congressional district so that the congressperson knows their job is on the line. And out of fear, they will become a co-sponsor, and they know that if they do not vote to pass the bill when it goes to the floor, they will lose their jobs. So that's the thought I'd like you to keep in mind, because that's very important. Our votes do count. We just have to get them unified. Okay, that's all there was. Bruce had a message that I missed, and he said you answered his original question that he had his hand raised for. So at this point, we're ready to go into the special topic, Paul.
I love this special topic. It's about how does the fair tax benefit the lower income? The fair tax benefits the lower income and the impoverished the most. It's just the opposite of our present tax code. Our present tax code has $1.2 trillion of standard deductions, itemized deductions, loopholes and exemptions and exceptions and whatever. Now, some 60% of us, when we're filing our personal income taxes, we take the standard deduction. We don't even use the long form. So most of us are just using the standard deduction, some 60% of us. So the itemized deductions are of no value to us. Those are only of value to those who have more wealth and more income to begin with. But the fair tax moves the tax base from production to consumption. Now, this makes it easier for everybody to save. And you have to save to gain wealth. We've talked about the 22 cents per dollar of hidden business taxes. Now, they're a lot more than that, but they're hidden. The fair tax will eliminate on average the 22, 23 cents. But these are regressive payroll taxes. Now, the same people that don't like regressive taxes forget about this little hidden tax that only gets paid by businesses as a regressive tax. In the job creation, the economic stimulus, who is this going to help the most? Well, you know, the lower income have a better chance of getting a better job or a job at all. It eliminates the payroll taxes. Now that's the 7.65% of gross pay. That now becomes disposable income. And the tax holding is gone. And tax withholding is gone. That further helps the spendable income. You control, under the fair tax, you control when you pay the tax and how much tax you pay by this pay-as-you-spend tax system. If you don't have a lot of money, you're not going to be able to pay a lot of taxes. You're not going to, and you don't have to file every year to get your rebate, to get your prebate. As far as the prebate goes, I should point out that to get the prebate, you are going to have to register. And this is telling the Social Security Administration, sending in an annual report to them, is what is your family size with Social Security numbers. Now, somebody passed away, yeah, they're no longer in your family. Somebody moves out of the house, you're no longer in the family. You have a new child, welcome to the family. But this monthly tax prebate helps the lower income, and it's the only tax break. It's the only tax break in the fair tax. And this one tax break helps the lower income and the impoverished the most. And the prebate puts the care and feeding of the family before paying federal taxes. The prebate further increases spendable income because the prebate is money that you can spend. Look at this example. Take an $8 per hour wage earner. Their weekly spendable income would increase by 41%. That's over $100 per week, over $5,400 per year. That's their spendable income. I suppose that 41% is going to be enough to cover the 23% fair tax. But along the way, they have their freedom back. There's no marriage penalty. It doesn't tax used goods. And the repealing of the 16th Amendment, we get freedom, liberty, and civil rights back. Today, you know, we have IRAs and 401ks and HSAs and SEP plans and college savings programs. All of these are little ways for the government to give back some of the lost freedom. you can save, under the Fair Tax, you can save as much as you're able to save, tax-free. You don't have to save today and not be able to spend it until you retire. You can save today. A young couple can save today so that they have the down payment to buy a new house next year or a couple years from now without any tax penalty. So the Fair Tax is a huge, huge help to the lower income. Now, the immediate action is required. I hope that I've gotten you excited about the Fair Tax, and you're asking yourself, what can I do? First of all, join the Fair Tax cause at fairtax.org. We've already talked about joining the 1040 Club to contribute. We need funds to support our programs and our infrastructure and to get a presence in Washington, D.C. Go to the Fair Tax website and sign the petition, and it will automatically be sent to your representative and two senators. Call your U.S. representative and two senators and ask them to become co-sponsors. If they're already a co-sponsor, thank them for being a co-sponsor. And do that every month. And you can go to Pop Box and vote for the Fair Tax bill, H.R. 25 and S. 155. So, Larry, that completes my presentation on how the Fair Tax helps the poor and the low income and the impoverished.
Okay, Paul, very good. Thank you so much. I'm just looking and I do not see any new questions. So let me take this opportunity to add a couple of thoughts that I jotted down. You've invited him to go to PopVox, and that's great. I want to mention that regarding the prebate, qualifying for the prebate has nothing to do with citizenship. If you are here legally, you have a green card, for example, you're here legally. And if you get yourself a Social Security account, you can get the prebate. For those who are here illegally, they do not qualify for the prebate, which means they'll do one of two things. They'll either deport themselves back to where they came from, typically that's been Mexico, or they'll be contributing to our revenue stream from the very first dollar that they spend. They'll be paying 23%, 23 cents out of every dollar in Fair Tax. Okay. Second comment I had is that it's a little bit of a comparison, income tax versus Fair Tax. Under the income tax, under any income tax, okay, it requires us to beg to get a refund in our tax return that we submit. Under the Fair Tax, you keep all of your money and only pay a tax when you consume new goods and services. And as Paul mentioned a couple of times, if you buy something used, and that could be anything from clothing to appliances to automobiles, boats, airplanes, houses, whatever, if you buy it used, you don't pay any tax on those. If you buy it new, you do. Okay, so those are a couple things I thought about. Now, we've got a guy that I admire for a long time on the line here, and I'm going to ask him if he's got any thoughts he would like to add. I hope I'm not waking you up out there in California, Mr. Splane. But, Bill, if you will click your hand and raise it so that I can unmute your microphone, I would be very pleased to have you say a couple of words to these people who have joined us tonight. There you go. You're on the air, Bill. Hello? No, you're not quite on the air. Bill, would you click the hand on your control box? There you go. Okay, if I click the hand and then this, I can't get you turned on, Bill. I am very sorry, but for whatever the reason is, and I've turned your hand off in an attempt to get you turned on, and that didn't work either. Attendee is self-muted. Oh, Bill, you've muted yourself. Click the mute button, the microphone icon on your control panel. No, that's the hand. Click the microphone icon. I think you've got it, Bill. Try it again. I mean, try talking. Not yet. Jiminy crickets, come on. You are unmuted. We should be able to hear you if your microphone's working. Okay, Bill, well, I'm sorry. I guess you and I are going to have to practice this so we can get you on the air with us and get some of the vast knowledge that you have to offer. Thank you so much for giving it a try anyway. Okay, Paul, that's about it for the night. We can close it out here, and we're a couple minutes early, so that's good. I would like to once again remind everybody to go to PopVox. You can vote on any legislation in PopVox, but of course we're concerned with voting in the affirmative for HR 25 or S 155. And there are other bills that you can vote in opposition of. One is S 969, the other is HR 1040, and there's probably a couple of others out there, but if you're on the system and you're getting the emails that are being passed around, mostly on Yahoo groups, you will be seeing messages that say, hey, here's another tax bill that we need to go and vote on, or here's an article that was written or published in some magazine or newspaper that's downing the fair tax, and we sure love for you to get on there and maybe write your comments to the author of that article, pointing out why he is mistaken in his views of the fair tax. That's the kind of activity, the kind of activist operation that we would like to encourage you to do. And of course, as Paul mentioned, speak to your congressional representative and your two U.S. senators' offices. Just call the office locally in the state that you're in and leave the message. They'll record it. And next month when you call back, they don't know who you are, so they'll record it again. And as long as there's a steady stream of calls, they'll know that there's activity going on in their area of concern. And if you live close enough to your congressman or your senator where you can walk into the office and sign their register and tell them that you want them to advocate for the fair tax, that is even better. So try and do that. With that, I will say good night, and Paul, leave the last word to you.
I just want to say good night also, everybody. Thanks for attending, and have a great evening.